leaders always practice the three R's: respect for self, respect for others, and responsibility for all actions. I take this opportunity to invite Dr. P.T. Srinivasan, head of the Department of Biochemistry, to address the gathering. Please, sir.
A very warm good morning to all of you. I welcome you all for this yet another webinar in our Silver Jubilee series that we are celebrating in our department. So the speaker is a very known person to us. Some of you might have seen him in the previous years. He has come here, he has participated in some of the one or two programs. So he is a new face to us. And the topic of this webinar is a more relevant topic of the day: transforming yourself in the pandemic era. So you have to transform yourself. Some of you might have already got transformed. Some of you are in the process of getting transformation, and some are still waiting, should I transform, like that. So these three questions, I hope it will be addressed by the speaker today, on what is the type of transformations that an individual needs to undergo as a student, as a teacher, as a parent, as anybody in any walks of life in this society. So now this COVID has forced all of us to really get transformed. And one thing what I have witnessed and seen in the teaching profession is those who are not used to computers for a very long time, except for seeing mails or something else, I started vigorously using the computer. I don't know how they took it, whether the transformation was smooth or whether it was a horrible experience, I don't know. But still, yet whatever be the situation, they have, many of us now have become experts. This I can tell with much authenticity, because whenever I try to conduct a program in my department or in the college, sir, I will do this. I will teach how to do online course, how to do online test. Then everybody, no need, sir, we know everything. You don't have to tell this. So I have to literally ask for everybody, oh, please come for the program. I will tell you how to do this EO attainment. Please come for the program, how to do this EO attainment. People will say, oh, just because of the respect they have, some of them will come. Others are good. I'm happy about it in the sense that they have transformed. They got transformed from a quasi or semi-literate computers and become fully professional in computers. Professional in the sense, basically MS Office stuff and Google. So I hope this topic is much relevant in the present context scenario. So with not much of deliberations, I invite you once again all for this wonderful webinar. So hope the speaker is able to address all our aspirations regarding the transformation, which I said in the beginning. Thank you for inviting me in this program. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I would like to call our dear assistant professor, Mr. Sangeeta Satyanarayanan, to introduce the speaker.
Very good morning to all. It gives me immeasurable pride and pleasure in welcoming our speaker for the day, Mr. Vaidheeswaran Vedagiri. I say pride because Vaidheeswaran is one amongst our celebrated alumni. As per college records, he is supposed to have left the organization in 2008 with a master's degree in biochemistry. But in essence, he never left this place. He has remained connected to this organization, his alma mater. He has contributed intellectually to the growth of this department. So it's always a pleasure to have you in our midst. Mr. Vaidheeswaran Vedagiri is a learning and development consultant who has over 13 years of experience in the training and development industry. He consults for domestic and international organizations, including Fortune 500 companies. A certified learning experience designer and a trainer by trade, our speaker for today specializes in performance needs analysis, design thinking, instructional design, and developing learning strategies to motivate learners from across the globe. He has conducted performance needs analysis for organizations like Cargill, Siemens, HSBC, and Mondelez, to name just a few. He has also delivered technical presentations on digital learning strategies to employees of NTPC, Ford, BMW, PayPal, and many more. He hosts the Empathetic Designer podcast on YouTube, which is recognized in the top list of L&D podcasts by the Training Industry magazine. But that's not all. Apart from all this, our speaker for the day is also a Carnatic music vocalist with over 17 years of training, formal training. He conceived the Antara Gandharam project aimed at preserving and propagating the rich cultural heritage of Indian classical music forms. So audience, we have a very multifaceted person amongst us this morning, a complete wholesome package to ignite young minds. I'm sure that you're all going to enjoy listening to him. So Vaidheshwaran, let me invite you to take this session forward with your talk on the topic, how we could transform our lives in the pandemic era. And I promise you, you have an equally wonderful audience. The stage is all yours. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for that wonderful introduction, ma'am. And it always gives me immense pleasure to come back to Digi Vaishnav and talk to all my professors and, of course, the students of the department. And I've been associated with the department. Like ma'am said, my date of delivery might have been 2008, but I have been associated with the department constantly. And I've been talking to students regularly, and it gives me great pleasure to come today and spend this Saturday morning with all of you and talk to you about transformation in the pandemic era. So let me first go ahead and share my screen so that we can get started. Okay. So once again, a very good morning to all of you. Experiences that we share unites us, and none unites us more than going through bad circumstances. When things go bad, we often ask this question, why? Why me? And why us? We always ask this question. It's fine. So it is a porcelain pot, yes. That is actually not a lining that you see. It is actually a broken porcelain vase. So this broken porcelain vase has been put together using gold. This is a Japanese art form known as kintsugi. It is the art of putting together broken pieces of pottery with gold. And this broken vase, which has undergone this process of kintsugi, is worth much, much more than an unbroken vase. See, life is full of challenges, right? So this is kintsugi, the spelling for kintsugi, if you are curious to know more about it. See, life is full of challenges, and it constantly gives us scars. How we bear our scars and heal those scars brings out the true transformation in us to become better people. See, some people might say that this vase is a porcelain vase, but it is broken. It is imperfect. But what we need to remember here, imperfection is the way of the world. There's nothing which is 100% perfect. So I think most of you are science students over here, and you can vouch for this particular fact that there is nothing which is 100% perfect. There is no 100% efficient system anywhere, right? So this concept in Japanese is called wabi-sabi. So true transformation is possible only when we learn to embrace our imperfections and make it endearing. Make it an endearing quality in us, like this vase over here. So you might be thinking, the topic is transformation in the pandemic era, and this man is coming here and talking about a broken vase. What is the connection? How is this vase going to help me? Well, I'm going to show you how this concept of wabi-sabi and kintsugi helped me personally. So I'm going to be spending today to talk to you about two chapters in my life which really helped me create a true sense of transformation. And it is the story of me sitting over here after 13 years from DGVC. Right? So let's get started and see what happens. So my story begins in April 2006. I completed my bachelor's degree in biochemistry. So this photograph that you see is a photograph of my UG classmates. So we met at the Marina Beach right after we completed our UG course, after our final examinations. It was a beautiful Saturday evening. We had a fantastic time and we made a promise to ourselves that we are going to do this every Saturday all through summer. And guess what? This was the last time we all met in this manner ever. We haven't met like this in this particular group ever since. It has been 13 years. Some of them wanted to go into jobs. They applied and they got jobs. Some of them wanted to pursue higher education, some in India, some in abroad. So we all went our separate ways. And as for me, my route was from UG to PG was very, very simple. I applied only to one college, which was DG Vaishnav College. There was an entrance test. I wrote it. 1 week later, I came to check out my results, saw my name at the top of the list, extremely happy, paid the fees, and I left. Which means I had 3 months of time to kill. Right? So it is summer vacation. 3 months time is there. I have got my PG admission. Doesn't that sound like a dream to you? No. It was not a dream. It was a nightmare for me. You'll be able to understand that when you get to see a glimpse of what my world was in 2006. So in 2006, I had 4 major superpowers in my hand. These were the 4 major superpowers. One was my trusted 1100, my Canon digital camera. The other one is a landline. And 4th one is, of course, Orkut, which was all hot at that time. But I lived in an era where there was no unlimited talk time. So we had to use only our landlines because that was the only one where the parents, I can slip the bill under my parents' radar, because if I'm going to use my mobile, the bill is going to come up and my parents are going to see, I mean, what the hell are you doing on your mobile? And when it comes to sharing photos, I have to take this digital camera, I have to charge it, and each time I have to put a photograph on Orkut, I have to physically connect this camera with the USB cable to my computer, transfer the photos to my hard disk, and upload it to Orkut. Can you even imagine doing these things today? And I lived in a world where we had no Wi-Fi, no smartphones. Like I was saying, I lived in a world where there was no Wi-Fi, no smartphones, no Facebook, no YouTube, no Twitter, no TikTok. None of this was there. I had internet, yes, but I didn't have anything. So think of this world today when you don't have all of this, you don't have any place else to go, you don't have friends to meet, and you're sitting at home. What's it going to be? How's life? And I was still a student, so I wasn't earning any money. So my dad didn't get me a 2-wheeler or anything like that. I just had my bicycle. So I was essentially trapped in my home with just one internet connection, no social media of any sort except for Orkut, and that's it. And I had to spend 3 months like this. I was fresh out of college, completed my UG. So literally the only thing I had in my hand was internet, nothing else. Nothing else was value to me because I'm not going to go out anywhere, so I don't need my camera. Of course, I can talk to some of my friends, but most of my friends are busy because they are going from college to college, getting admissions, or some of them have got jobs, so I can't really trouble them. And mobile, yes, I can probably send SMS, but no, nothing beyond that. So what did I do? So I went to the internet and I was browsing aimlessly. It was aimless until one morning. One particular summer morning, things changed. So how many of you in this audience have heard about Quora? Anyone in the audience who has heard about Quora? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, in 2006, there was no Quora. I had something else called Yahoo Answers. So I was just browsing aimlessly, and I stumbled upon this site Yahoo Answers. I was browsing through it just casually, looking at some questions, and I found that there were some questions that were not answered that were pertaining to biochemistry. And since I didn't have anything to do, I knew the answers. I didn't have anything to do, so I just went and answered those questions just for the heck of it. I anyway didn't know anything else to do, so I just went, answered those questions. I closed that browser, I came out, and I was doing my other stuff. The next day morning, I was in for a shock when I saw an avalanche of alerts on my Yahoo account. The next day, I see this avalanche of notifications for me saying some people have liked your answers, some people have responded to your answers, the original poster had thanked your answers, and they have ranked my answer. So in 2 days, I find myself sitting on a leaderboard competing with people in that area to answer questions. That seemed like a game to me. So I went ahead and did this for about 15 days. Something changed on day 16. On day 16, I'm getting an email from a person. So this person writes, "Hello, Mr. Vaidheeswaran. I have been seeing your answers on Yahoo Answers. You seem to know your subject very well. I'm from the US. I'm working on an assignment and I have some questions. Could you please help me answer those questions?" And in that last line, he has added, "Please let me know how much you charge for this service." I was shocked. I had no idea that I could charge money for answering questions, stuff that I knew. And the next problem came. I didn't know how much to ask. So I just said, so I knew this guy is from the US. So I told him, "You give me $1 per question." That was literally all I could think of. I sent him that mail. And he responded saying, "Mr. Vaidheeswaran, thank you for helping me. But I think $1 is very, very less. I will give you $10 a question. And I need 1 hour of your time." I said, "Okay, fine. Let's see how that goes." I was curious. So I set up that meeting with him. We had a conversation for about 45 minutes to 1 hour. And in the end, he told me, "Mr. Vaidheeswaran, you have answered 10 questions during these 45 minutes. So that brings the total to $100. And I'm going to send you a check." I thanked him and left the call. And I thought, okay, sending a check, like as if that's something real and something that's going to happen. In 1 week, I had a check in my mailbox for $100. I had no idea what to do with it. So I had to go to the bank. I had to ask them, "I've got this. What should I do?" So they directed me to the foreign exchange department and they made me fill up some forms and things like that. But in 2 days, I got the money. At that time, US dollars was around 39 rupees. So I got 3,900 rupees in my account just for spending 45 minutes. And that ignited something new. That gave me an idea. So why don't I do something and capitalize on this? I find this interesting. Somehow time is getting killed and I seem to be making money out of this. So I created a small website for myself. So at that time we had Google Pages. So now Google Pages is no longer there. But there was Google Pages. I created a free website for myself and I signed up for some platforms and I was advertising. I didn't spend the money on a rupee on this. All of this was free advertising. I just put it up there. I started getting students regularly to the extent that when I started my post-graduation from 2006 to 2008, the money which I made from taking these classes helped me pay for my college fees. My entire postgraduate fees was taken care of by that money. I was able to buy all the books I needed with that money. My parents didn't spend a rupee for me for my postgraduate education. I took care of it all by myself. So all of this sounds nice, So this is actually a picture of me hosting Solutions, the first edition of Solutions rather. So 2006 to 2008 was a joyride. I had a fantastic time in college. And as I scaled up this teaching online thing, a company approached me and said, we have seen your website. Would you like to do a demo for us? So I went there, I did a demo, and they hired me even before I completed my college. So this is February 2008. I got placed in a company before I could even complete my college. I was on their payroll. So I go to college from 11 to 4. And from at 4, I go back home, freshen up, go to this particular office at 6. So we were a UK-based company. So it was a startup. So from 6 to 12, I used to work there. I was getting a regular salary with that company. And I thought, this is all great. Life is going fantastic. And I'm going to start my own startup. Because I had lots of students. At my peak, I had around 15 to 20 students booking various slots. And they were learning from me. And I was making very good money. So I finished my college. I was all happy. I printed my business cards. And something happened. Look at the year. 2008. What is the first thing that comes to your mind when you see the year 2008?
There was a recession in my company.
Very good. There was a global recession that happened. Exactly. There was a global recession. It stemmed from the US and spread out all across the world. A lot of people were laid off and finances became tight for everyone. And just at the time when I was about to start my company, the recession hit. I lost every single student I had. Everyone went off. The flow of inquiries that were coming in completely stopped. And the company which hired me in February 2008 relegated me to a part-time role and cut me off from a regular salary system. I was paid by the hour. Their number of students also came down. So I just had 2 students and they paid me hourly to teach those 2 students. This was when I had already printed my business cards. I was ready to launch. And this happened. And since I already had a job, I didn't even bother with campus interviews or anything for that matter. So I didn't have a job. Fresh out of college, all business plans and everything ready. Suddenly everything went off. Does this feeling sound familiar to everyone? This is exactly what I went through when I finished college. So I had to do something. I finished my post-graduation. Now the family is looking for me to secure a job and start earning. And I don't have a job. So what I did was, okay. So one of my strong points was English. My language, my communication was quite good. So I went and took up an editorial job. I took a copy editing job in a small company. They were paying me around 6,000 rupees a month at that time. But at least I had something to say that I have a job. And I thought, okay, let me see what happens. I was also taking these classes on a part-time basis. Money was not good. And that editing job was fine. I did learn a lot. But it didn't feel really satisfying for me. I didn't know what to do. So what did I do? I started talking to people. So this particular company where I was doing part-time, they had a number of tutors. So I was talking to one of those tutors who was teaching English. And she told me about this field called instructional design. I had no clue what that was. She said, it's an upcoming field. A lot of people are going into it. It's something that I feel might suit you. Why don't you start learning about it? So what I used to do is after my day job, I used to go to this place a couple of hours early. And those 2 hours, I will sit and read about this new instructional design thing that I was introduced to, take my classes and come back. And I really liked what I saw with this instructional design. So what I did was, I was going through the motions. I learned what instructional design is. I connected with people on social media who had instructional design on their profile. I started talking to them. Told them I'm new. I want to learn. I started networking. They gave me a lot of resources. They were very forthcoming. And with that knowledge that I was able to secure from these people, I managed to snag an interview with a company which was into learning design and got my first job as an instructional designer. And I spent more time learning and reading and working with these people. And my second company in instructional design was IBM. I went to Bangalore. I worked with IBM. And then I moved back to Chennai to work with another company called eMantras for a few years. And then I moved to GP Strategies, where I am currently working. And incidentally, the company eMantras was acquired by GP Strategies. So I've got back the colleagues that I had with my previous company. So this is just a journey, a chance that I got to come to a position of where I am today and loving what I am doing. So what did I do here? I networked. I talked to people. I sat down and I didn't stop learning. I didn't let things like this put me down. Okay. So you may think, okay, that's a nice story, Vaidheeswaran. You've said a very nice story for me. But what about a real pandemic? You were not in a real pandemic for all, to give you the benefit. You were not in a real pandemic. Yes, you were stuck and all of that, but that's not a real pandemic. So what did you do in this real pandemic? That brings me to this second chapter of my life that I want to talk to you about. So I've been in this industry for all this time. I did very well. From a learning designer, I grew up in my career to become a learning consultant. And this is a selfie that I took in March 2020, the last business travel that I did for this company before the pandemic hit. This was in the first week of March of 2020. So me being a consultant for this particular company, and we have a lot of clients, my job entails a lot of travel. My job is to travel to my client sites, talk to people, learn from them, and give them ideas and solutions. That's my job at a very high level. So my job is all about travel. It's all about social interaction. It is all about connecting and networking with people. And I've been doing this for such a long time. And in March 2020, all of that stopped. No social interactions. There was no learning happening. And it felt nice for the first few months that I could work from home. I could work wearing my Bermudas and do my office work. And all of that fun was there. But all of that fun died down in less than a month. I could spend time with my family. All that was there. But it really didn't feel good after that 1 month. I felt lonely. I felt cut off. I'm sure as college students, you will also be feeling cut off from your friends and not enjoying the college life that others have had the opportunity to enjoy. I can fully understand that, because I had a whale of a time in my college days, and in my work, I had a fantastic time. I mean, in a month, I will be on travel for at least 2 weeks. I'll be going to new places, talking to new customers, getting requirements, coming out with plans, coming up with visuals and ideas, and it was total fun. Now all of that has stopped. So it is at this point that I really came to stumble upon the concept of sunflowers. So I would like to take a moment here to talk about sunflowers. You may be thinking, why? I'll tell you. See, sunflowers have this nature where the head of the flower follows the sun during the course of the day. As the sun rises from the east and sets on the west, the sunflower orients its flower head to the east, moves up, and then turns to west. This is what sunflowers do. But what do they do on cloudy and rainy days? Right? For example, if the day is going to be cloudy, and if it is going be a rainy day. There is no sun. There is no visual reference for sunflowers. And they thrive on that action that they perform to orient themselves to an energy source, to gather energy, to gather that strength and stay in bloom. What will happen if it's going to be a rainy season? What will the sunflowers do? On a cloudy or a rainy day, when the sun is not visible, sunflowers have this very peculiar characteristic. They turn around and orient themselves towards each other. If you look at a sunflower field, the next time you go past a sunflower field any place on a cloudy day, you will be able to observe this. Sunflowers orient themselves towards each other and draw upon each other's energy to continue their survival. And this is something that that gave me a massive jolt. I felt there was a lesson for me over here. See, when we are in face to face with a crisis, the clouds of the pandemic are at the horizon, blocking the sun. We need to turn to our fellow human beings, draw from their experience, their knowledge, their energy, and get inspired and inspire others. And this is exactly what I did. So I got in touch with some of my contacts, and we created a network. It was nothing fancy. It was just a WhatsApp group. So we created a network and we created a platform where we fixed it in such a way that every single day, barring Sundays, someone from the community will come and address the rest of the group for an hour on their area of expertise. It could be anything. It could be anything. It could be just about anything. Whatever is your strength, you come and talk to us. We started as a group of 10 people. We started this in January. We are in the first week of June. And we have 6,000 people in our network now. The platform is free for everyone. Anyone can come and join. The meetings are also free. You can just come, just listen to people. If you want to contribute something by talking to, by addressing the audience, it's totally your call. If you don't want to, that's absolutely fine. You come sit and learn. So when we created this community and we were learning from each other, we actually got to see a positive impact of this particular community. So I'm going to tell you a small incident that happened with this particular community. So we were all doing this knowledge sharing thing. And there was this one lady who came on the platform and she said she wanted to talk about storytelling. So we gave her the platform. She talked about stories and she had a story of her own. Her husband had lost his job during the COVID pandemic and they are living off their savings. They're not having any income. This is the background. She didn't tell this explicitly during her presentation, but we later found this out. So one member from this audience was an industrialist. So this is actually a very heterogeneous group. So we have students, we have industrialists, we have people from corporate backgrounds, we have trainers, we have freelancers, we have a whole bunch of people over there. So this one gentleman, he came up on the call and he asked her, would you be interested in joining my company in my training division? She got her job on the spot. This was one of the successes that I really cherish, and it only strengthened my resolve in the power of creating networks and participating in networks to further your cause and your career. So, in my view, a true sense of transformation in difficult times like this can be achieved only when we look at our fellow human beings. We try to learn from each other. We create opportunities for each other and we grow together. So when I say this, I'm reminded of this famous lines from Subramanya Bharati, where he says, Sendriduveer ettu thikkum, kalai selvangal yavum konar ningu serpeer. So people who are not familiar with Tamil, I have got the translation down there. So this is what this is the vision that Mahakavi Bharati had set so many years back, and see how beautifully relevant it is today. So you may think, okay, Vaidyeshwaran, so you are telling, okay, so you're part of a community, it has a lot of people, you are learning from each other and all of that. So you have still not told me what special thing has happened to you as part of this particular transformation. What is special that has happened to you? How did this community has impacted you as part of this process? Then I'll tell you. I did something unthinkable last Monday. Something that people wouldn't dream of during this pandemic. I've resigned my job. I'm a working professional sitting in a very comfortable position as a consultant in a multinational company with a very good salary. I have no risk of losing my job, but I quit. Have I got another job in another company? No, I haven't. So what am I going to do? I have decided to start my own learning and development practice. And you won't believe, I have 6 memorandums of understandings sitting in my inbox, and I'll have to pick and choose which one I need to sign to get my practice started. I have people calling me ever since the word of me quitting my company got out. I have people calling me and asking me, will you be ready to work with me? I'm right now serving my notice period, and I can't wait to start my L&D practice in August. So that is going to be my next chapter in my professional career, and I will definitely keep all of you and the department apprised of how things are going with me, and I'm sure it's going to go in a fantastic way. So I was talking to you about these 4 mantras. I was talking to you about networking, and the key to achieve transformation is through connecting with like-minded people and getting introduced to new people. But when you go on a platform and connect with people, I'm sure all of you would have found by now that, I'm assuming all of you are on social media, and you would have seen numerous arguments, numerous fights, numerous disagreements happening between members of your friend circle, or probably from people in your community or various groups and things like that. So networking is great, but however, it's not a path without its pitfalls. You need to remember that it takes all kind of people to make up this world, and you will meet all these kinds of people on networking forums. And when you're connecting with people, you'll meet all kinds of people. There are no associations created without arguments. And considering the pandemic situation right now, our boiling points have been considerably reduced. We are already in a lot of frustration and my friends are not keeping well. People who have known, who I know very well, are affected by COVID. It's a lark. Right? So you might think that maybe I'm not in the right mental framework to do this. Maybe the person I'm talking to might not be in the right framework to do this. Is this even the right time to do this? It is definitely the right time to do this. So to succeed in an endeavor like this, to create a sense of transformation in you, it is important to keep a level head and razor focus, sharp focus only on your objective, which is to transform yourself and achieve the goals that you have set for yourself. So I'm going to take you through 4 mantras to achieve this. So what is a mantra? A mantra is a magical formula, if you really ask me. Every time you pronounce a mantra, you can transform the situation right away. There is no waiting period for this mantra. There is no incubation period, no practice period. Nothing is required. All you'll have to do is concentrate and recite this mantra without any qualms. And when you recite these mantras without any qualms, without any sort of misgivings, or mana varutham, or mana klesham illama, when you say these four mantras, you will be able to see results instantaneously, and you will start developing a fan base for yourself. So I'm going to show you these four mantras. The first mantra is the easiest. This mantra is a practice and not a declaration. That is something that you need to remember. It's by saying, I'm here for you. To love someone means to be there for them, not just in person, but in conscious. You should be there fully, not only physically. And this especially applies during the period of pandemic. See, when someone is lost in their past or future, they get confused. And when you say, I am here for you, when you use the word here, it immediately brings them to the present and makes them want to listen to you. You are opening your arms when you say that I'm here for you. In fact, when I look at this mantra every time, I'm here for you, I always remember this Ashtapadi composed by Jayadeva. This is from the 16th Ashtapadi, where he talks about this idea of the power of being consciously present. He says, Vikasita sarasija lalitha mukhena sputati nasa manasija rishikena. So it means she does not suffer from the sharp arrows of a cupid, since she is with him who has the face of a full moon, which means there is no sense of separation, because you have internalized the other person in you. You see that person in you. And when you do that, there is no way you can get into an argument with that person. And when you say, I am here for you, that is the ultimate expression of true love. Let's go to the second mantra. The second mantra is used to acknowledge the presence of a person that you love, and you communicate the fact that you are extremely happy that they are there for you. It is not just physical availability. This is at a conscious level. When you thank a person saying that they are consciously available for you, and you say, I know you are there and I'm happy for that, you make the other person happy instantaneously, irrespective of their mood. So when you say, I know you are there and I'm happy for that, you're saying that it is you that matters to me. You matter to me more than I matter to myself. And remember that there is nothing in this world that is more precious than mindful presence. And this mantra, the first mantra was the ultimate expression of love. The second mantra is the ultimate expression of gratitude. Go to the third mantra. The first two mantras help in ending an unpleasant exchange before it even begins. So what happens when an unpleasant exchange has already happened? So someone says something, you at the heat of the moment say something back. So something has been done. So what do? The third mantra is to help you take onus of the situation. You take ownership of that situation and you take the first step and be the bigger person. And when you say, I feel your pain and I'm here for you. So when you say this to another person, it makes them understand that you, irrespective of whatever you said, you are a true friend, and you realize, you personally realize the amount of pain that you have caused on that person, and you have set in motion the process of healing. And this mantra is the ultimate expression of empathy. Now the fourth mantra. The fourth mantra is a bit more difficult to say from a psychological perspective, because this mantra is going to help you fight an enemy that is inside you before you even go and fight the enemy that is outside you. And that enemy is your ego. When you say, I'm suffering, I'm trying my best, please help me. When you say something like this, you're not only winning over the other person, you're winning with against yourself as well, because you have created a situation where you have opened your arms and you are expressing your heart to that other person with whom you're talking to and soliciting them. You are positioning them at a level where you are expecting them to help you without saying that they are going to be helping themselves by helping you. So if you see this mantra, it has three parts. The first part is, I am suffering. So here you are sharing something. And when you say the second part, I am trying my best, you are actually having two things happening here. So one is, you are trying to respond to the situation. And number two, you are making a point here that you are making a conscious effort to not only heal the situation, but to correct yourself in that process. And number three, when you say, please help me, you have put that person on a pedestal and you are indirectly helping them to heal and get out of the situation. So remember that your suffering is their suffering as much as your happiness is their happiness. So when you connect with people and when you are looking to transform yourself by learning, by acquiring knowledge, by acquiring friendship, reconciliation is the best path for both you and your community to move forward. So build networks, build relationships, and I'm sure you will all transform yourself in this pandemic era. So at this point, I would like to conclude with just one more thing that I would like to say to people all over here. So the alumnus have been meeting quite frequently, at least if not in person, we are meeting on social media platforms. And one of the things that we personally regret is that our juniors are not reaching out to us. We personally regret this. During our college days, you will find our professors, I'm sure Professor Sangeeta or Uma ma'am will definitely attest to the fact that our batch students, more than roaming amongst ourselves, will be roaming around with our seniors. We got so much knowledge. We got so much from their experience. And a lot of people have shaped their careers because of the influence of our seniors and the amount of help that they have extended to us. And we, who have now become seniors, would like to extend the same open arms that we got from our seniors to people from the department. And we would be most happy to talk to all of you and help you during this particular period of a pandemic and to guide you, if required, to get into whatever your aspirations and dreams are. And one of the beautiful things about our particular department especially is, I'm sure the rest of the other departments also do this, but since I am from the biochemistry department, I personally know this, that the department has a well up-to-date register of all the alumnus, what we are doing today, and what our contact information is. Everything is available in the department. So please go to the department, talk to people, come talk to me. And I think we have people from different colleges over here as well in the audience. And this invite from me goes to all of you. Now that you have been part of my talk over here, you are also welcome. Please reach out to me If you have any questions, if you have any concerns, if you need anything to shape your career and go down this path of transformation, reach out to me, reach out to your seniors, create a network for yourself. You won't believe the amount of transformation that you will get. And 13 years down the line, you will be sitting where I am sitting right now and talking to your juniors and giving them the same message that I got from my seniors 13 years back. And on that note, I would like to thank you all for being patient and listening to me. And I would like to thank the department for inviting me. Thank you.
Sometimes you will never know the value of moment until it becomes a memory. Thank you, sir, for your eye-opening session. It was really mind-blowing. Dear friends, it's time for you all to make the session more interesting and interactive with your valuable questions.
Aitishwaran, I have question.
Yes,
so,
sir.
What tips that you will give to our students, I mean your juniors, during this pandemic era? Like, most of them are not familiarized with attending the classes online. So they have been doing so for the past 1.5 years.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how they feel about it. Is it okay with them or not okay with them, etc. So,
absolutely.
I don't know whether they are learning properly. I mean, learning to their satisfaction, like what you have been describing about your learning process. I don't think it should be that much amount of satisfaction they may have when they have a physical contact classes. So what tips that you give to your juniors to console themselves during this pandemic era on their online way of learning things?
Okay, absolutely. That's a great question, sir. I would really love to address this point. See, friends, you're not alone. The problems, the inhibitions, the mental pain that you are facing by sitting at home in a remote manner and learning and taking your classes, this is the same feeling that we have in corporates as well. The workforce of today are facing the exact same challenges as you are facing. So you are not alone. That's the first thing you need to remember. And number two, what you need to remember is, see, we are in a problem. We are facing a problem. We are facing a crisis. Yes. But there is definitely a solution to it. There is going to be an end to this. We are going to come out. But what you need to understand over here is that every time a door closes, another door opens. There are opportunities everywhere. It is just that you need to open your minds and look at those opportunities. Okay. So let's say, okay, so I'll come to your situation. So you are sitting at home. So you are taking classes online. Yes, it could be boring. What do you think could make this interesting? You have the power of internet with you. You have so much time in your hands. Why don't some of you volunteer, form a group, volunteer, take up a topic and say that I'm going to conduct this presentation. You use the same tools. You learn all these tools, how to use, how to make, Google Meet is one. There are other platforms like Zoom and all of that. You can sit and do something like that. You can create activities for people. You can make small projects. You can create quizzes. You can create events for your people, for your students. You can form small groups, do something like that. Keep yourself busy. That's the most important thing. Keep yourself busy. Keep thinking, what can I do? See, when you look at any organization, be it a school, a college, or a corporate, there is only so much that can come from the top. If you really have to succeed in life, you will have to pull your weight. It takes two hands to clap and make a sound. I'm sure the college management is definitely doing everything within its powers to make sure that you people are engaged. But the onus of making that successful lies with you. I'm sure that if you come up with ideas like this, the department will welcome you with open arms. I know Professor Dr. Srinivasan, I know all the faculty members over here. They will welcome you with open arms when you come up with something like this. Create an activity for yourself. Form a group. So there's a Newberg crew over there. You guys get together or form another group. You have a group of friends that you've connected with. See, one of the challenges that we face over here, especially for people who have joined their first years of either UG or PG, is that you have never seen each other. Right? So form a community for yourself. Create a group. I mean, I was talking about the network where I am in. I'm connected to 5,000 people. And out of that 5,000 people, I have met only 4 people in person. The remaining 4,996 people I've never even seen. And I have a fan club over there. When I conduct a program, these people are the first ones to come and register for that program. And they cheer for me in that meeting and in my programs. Now, why is that happening? It is because of this sense of community. See, as life science students, I don't have to spell this out to you. Man is a social animal. We are nothing without our society. We are nothing without our communities. If you don't have a community, you create a community. Don't wait for others to make things, to bring things over to you. The world doesn't work that way. You bring something, you take an initiative, you start something, take it to your professors. I am sure they will welcome you with open arms. They will give you some ideas. Actually, when I was doing my online classes, I used to have a lot of frequent interactions with PTS sir. And he used to give me what he calls as sparks. So I used to allude that to that expression, sparks, where he'll give me saying, I used to share with him like all of the stuff that I used to do. I tell him that I take classes and I have students like this. This is some of the subject matters I take. So he used to give me a lot of ideas. Why don't you try something like this? Why don't you do something like this? And then when I made it quite public that I am taking classes online, professors like Sangeeta ma'am asked me to take some classes for the department as well. So we used to fight. I mean, we were actually a gang, myself and there were two or three other guys. We used to fight among ourselves. And when the syllabus document was given to us, we will voluntarily go to the staff room and declare to the staff that this portion of the syllabus, we will be conducting the classes. You guys can step back. You can guide us. Definitely, we will come to you for your guidance. But we are taking ownership of this particular section and we are going to be doing this. You won't believe the amount of support that the department gave to me when we told this. They booked AV rooms for us and it was not like us coming and talking in front of a class. They made sure they booked proper AV rooms with proper equipments for us to make this happen. So we are in a pandemic right now and there are a lot of digital platforms that are available. Why don't you work on something, some platforms, just do some exploration to see how can I make this class more interesting? How can this class be made more interesting? So I'm having a dialogue with my teacher. My teacher is asking questions and I'm answering questions. Can this be made more fun? Can we convert this into a game? There are umpteen number of possibilities. All you'll have to do is sit and think as a group and you won't believe the flow of ideas you will get. Just block a Sunday, have a Google Meet party or Zoom party, bring some snacks, sit together, have chit chat, and then get into this. You won't believe the amount of ideas that you'll be able to generate. All of those ideas might not come to fruition, but even if two or three come to fruition, you will know that you have created a trend. You have created something new and you have created something that is going to benefit everyone in your, not only your class, but in the classes that are going to follow. I hope that answer was, I hope I answered your point, sir.
Yeah, okay. Students have to take initiatives.
Definitely.
They have to be proactive.
Yes.
Thank you, sir, for your lucid answers. Gratitude is the ability to experience life as a gift. It liberates us from the prison of self-preoccupation. I would like to invite Ms. Sanju Vikasni from First MSc Biochemistry to deliver the vote of thanks.
A valuable gift to someone you love is called prayer. Thank you is one such among them. I consider it a great privilege and opportunity to propose a oath of thanks to the memory who had made a memorable and successful event. I would like to thank Abhiha, secretary and principal for this support, and the head of the department who took this initiative to give this wonderful, knowledgeable section to us. On behalf of UT Vaishnava College, I would like to thank our chief guest, Mr. Vaitheeswaran Vedagiri, for spending his valuable time with us to engage our mind with his wonderful thoughts. My heartfelt thanks to my lovely faculty who had always been there for us to guide us, support us, and lead us in the right direction towards successful career. Last but not least, I thank all my fellow students and my friends for participating in this program. Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you, everyone.